So now I invite another participants who wants to say something in his or her minds. We have a comments early in
yep
chat from Mr. Marudut. He's
okay, sir, I can deliver directly here.
Yeah. Please deliver your here. Your comments directly to Mr. Early.
Thank you, Sir Dwi and Kak Jakaria. So actually, especially in Jabodetabek, in Jakarta, can you hear me, everybody? Excuse me?
Yes.
Yeah,
clearly.
Especially in Jabodetabek or metropolitan city in Indonesia, but focusly for private school, they actually applied English out of the context. So, you know, our curriculum at K13. K13 is a must for the school, the curriculum, the 2013 curriculum. But some private school applied or even integrate or adopt Cambridge curriculum. But out of this one also for like what? I don't know if Miss Joanna or Miss Trisa know about this one, but some of our school in Indonesia, especially in Jakarta, if we cannot really apply for English teachers from Australian or from American or from Europe, we will hire Filipino teacher. Because it's actually for the second option, if for the students to be applied or taught by the teachers for those speaking English. Because as we know, Filipinos talk more in English than Indonesian. We admit that. That's why many Philippine teachers come to Indonesia as the English teacher, especially for teaching Cambridge. So again, Kak Jakaria, actually, the government just only apply English for only 2 periods or 3 periods or even 4 for public school. But for private school, they have a freedom to do that one, especially for the school who are named as SPK. Pak Dwi have heard SPK before, right? International school or even national school, we apply that one. But yes, for a primary, especially for private school, most of them can speak in English, most of them in Jakarta, for example, and in Bandung. But for public school, yeah, we are limited. Or the public school, which is actually obtained by for the religious school. Contohnya sekolah Katolik, sekolah Muslim gitu. They actually adapt for the government rules because, you know, some of them still supplied by the government from Dana Bos. It means they have to follow the rules of the government. But some private school, they will apply them their own rules. That's why most of them actually can speak in English. But the truth is, ladies and gentlemen, in Indonesia, even in UPI or many schools, banyak universitas di Indonesia itu, almost all, around 60-70% have English program. Di UPI ada, di UI ada, UNJ, always have English program to be applied there. So every year, there will be around 10,000 graduates of English, whether if it is English education graduates, English literature graduates, or even another like linguistic one. So actually, we have resources. Kita punya sumber daya manusia to speak in English. So just only wait for the government to turn it on.
I think it's true that. That in private school, the parents can ask request to the school to have English after school, but to public school, sekolah negeri, they cannot offer it because of the budget. So in my opinion, this is a big loss for young people. Even more for young indigenous, for the people who are living in the metropolitan city, they are still struggling. Only a limited of percentage of the student can learn English, but all of them cannot easily access to English language due to the policy of the government for the time being. But we do hope that in the future it will change because the ASEAN country has proclaimed that English is the working language daily in the office of the ASEAN office in Jakarta. So, for example, if we, I once went to Brunei Darussalam. In Brunei Darussalam, Bahasa Melayu and English is being taught side by side. For example, from 1 hour Malay Brunei, and then the other Malay English language. So here we didn't have such kind of things. So my prediction that in the future, these children who are living at the moment will have learning English lost, yeah, because of the government did not realize the importance of English. It does not mean because I am from English subject background, but to be winning the competition, one of the competency is that mastering English. I think that's my opinion. Yeah. Thank you so much, Pak Zakaria. And who's the last person asked, Pak?
Mr. Marucuk.
Yeah, Mr. Marucuk.
Yeah, it's sounds from our country, from Indonesia. Also,
yeah, from Indonesia.
Maybe we will have another sounds from overseas, but now we have Mr. Sahad. He is our participants from currently living in Taiwan. Please, Mr. Sahad.
Oh, Taiwan. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah. Professor Haley. Thank you for sharing your knowledge with us today. But I still have something to ask about what is actually the reason from the government, I mean that Indonesian government, to drop out the English subject in primary school? Because before Mr. Zakaria mentioned that the students can only learn 2 hours. It means it is not very productive. But we know some subjects in elementary school, mostly they only have 2 hours. So I just want to know what is actually the reason from the government? Because if we want to know about how children acquire the new language actually when they are younger, it is the best time for them to learn new language. But in reality, Indonesian government, they drop out the subject, I mean English subject. So I just want to know the reason. Yeah, maybe because Professor Harley, he's from Indonesian government curriculum's representatives. Maybe he can let us know. Yeah, and the second questions. So before this time, what is teaching English for young learners in Indonesian context? I'm from the teacher side and also from the curriculum. I mean, English teacher for young learners, what kind of requirements they have to to teach the children? And also in the content of the curriculum, what are they? Maybe we want to learn from your country. We want to know, yeah, what was happened in the past time. Thank you, Professor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sahad, for your great question. As I already mentioned, that there is a big ideological battle between the treason or maybe feeling the threaten from a foreign country through English. So they think that English is very fond of by the young generation at the time, maybe five years ago. So the policymaker in Indonesia is trying to reduce the influence of the foreign country through English. So they decide to leave out, to omit, to exclude English from elementary school. No more English in elementary school. In junior school, only 2 hours. In senior school, only 4 hours. Yeah, cut off by 50%. So there is kind of what is it called? Threaten from overseas through English. They think that their young generation nationality will be lessened by and will be overcome by English language. So they try to boost, to add up the hours of Bahasa or Indonesian language time for young generation in elementary school, junior school, and senior school or high school. That's the biggest reason for our government at that time. But now I have already been making research, yeah, that it is turning turning worse than before, that the capacity of or the competency of the students from elementary graduate from public school has less capacity because English is not taught at school. Among the ASEAN country, I've already made the research about this. Yeah. Among the ASEAN country, Indonesia is the lowest in English literate. One of the biggest contribution is from primary sectors. That's one point. The other point, what is young learner competency in Indonesian? Of before English is banned, yeah, excluded from the main curriculum, we have the program of pilot project for international school, yeah, starting from elementary, junior school, and then high school. That's the time where we have a golden English teaching time. The students are chanting, the students are bubbling, the students are mimicking using English because they can communicate in English very well at that time. There are sister school relationship between Indonesian and Australian and in many other English speaking country. The student can go to Australia, for example, for 1 month, staying at a homestay in Australian family, and they can survive. You can imagine elementary school by group, placing in Australian homes, yeah, in a sister school relationship. That's the ideal of, that's the golden time when English is very, very important at that time. So I can learn from my research that the student in elementary school can go for a month accompanied by a teacher to Victoria, to Melbourne, and they can sit in the classroom. Yeah. follow the instruction in English. You can imagine. This is very amazing. And their buddy, their friends, vice versa in return, can directly learn Bahasa Indonesia from the main source, from the native Indonesian children. So here I would like to stress that English has to be written like 5 years ago, but it needs a lot of effort, need a lot of political support, yeah, especially from the community. But for the time being, in elementary school, no more English. English only 2 hours in junior school and 4 hours in senior school. That's all I can say, Mr. Sahat. Thank you very much for your participation from Taiwan, right? I have also yes. been going to Taiwan, to Tainan City, especially to Tainan Technology University in Tainan. Yeah, I have a friend there. And English is also good at Taiwan.
I just want to clarify, sir, if mm-hmm. I'm not mistaken, so the government wanted to protect your national language, right? Something like that?
Yes, that's right. That's right. They feel that English will threaten our nationality identity because even the young generation is banned to use English. Now many people still using English because English is international language. English words is everywhere.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
I agree actually, because English, it is not science, it is just a skill, right? So it is not very important, I think, for, you know. And also I read some sources that because in Indonesia, especially in elementary schools, the students has more subjects. They have more subjects. They have a lot of things to do. They are very tired. Yeah, something like that. But it just... people's opinion actually, but now I can know it from you, sir.
That's right, about maybe 9 to 11 subjects, so burdening the students. They have to study many subjects. What I know from Australia, just only maybe language, art, science, sport, yeah, four subjects. But they can learn it in joyful situation learning. But here we have maybe 9 to 11 subjects. Many materials should be mastered by the student here in Indonesia. Yeah, maybe we will gradually change, hopefully, in the future. Like at the moment, from one school to the other school can learn each other. Because at the moment, we have a revolutionary learning called freedom to learn. Yeah. From one school to other school, from junior to other junior can learn each other, from university in a country and university overseas can learn each other. It's now hopefully can endorse and support the returning of English in the main curriculum.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Many reason exist instead of only political and also learning loads during this policy. So that's sounds from Taiwan. And also, now we have another participants want to say something, by Ellie. Maybe we will uh-huh. have sharing from Philippines. So please, Joanna.
Joanna?
Yes, actually, it's a question. Good afternoon, Mr. Hurley. I just have a question concerning the, if you mentioned earlier the challenge to bring back English to the main curriculum of Indonesia. If ever that would be pushed through by the government and other policymakers, what do you think are the considerations that should be made so that the same situation before where there was a threat in national language? That's the reason that you mentioned earlier. That's why they dropped the English to the main curriculum. So if ever that English would be brought back to the main curriculum, what should be the consideration so that problems before or the threats that was seen before would not be seen if ever in the future?
Thank you, Joanna, for your question. I think sometimes our government, our Indonesian government policy, possibly changed by, for example, through protests. Yeah, so we should have smartly protest to the government. It has to be a change in English language policy. And other thing, maybe should, it is very clear, yeah, in ASEAN level that Indonesian young generation is left behind from their counterpart, from their body among ASEAN country, because they have something in their mind, but they cannot express it in good English. Why? Because the degree of the involvement of the student to English is very limited. So in my opinion, it has to be a lot of protest in to the central government in Jakarta, and it has to be a scholarly initiative telling that, look, in other country, English is now coming to the central, like in Thailand or in Philippines. Philippines have a long history relation with United States. So English is really their daily life of expression. So in my opinion, the government should listen to the aspiration from the people, yeah. Because now we cannot compete with other nation if we didn't master the language accepted internationally. Thank you, Joanna.
And about tackling down the arguments of influence language through our bahasa, Pak Erli.
Yeah. At the beginning of our reformation era, at the time, people is very free to express their mind. But the scary thing from the policemaker in Jakarta is that so many sentences mix between Indonesian language and English language. Even sometimes they can chit-chat in more English fluently rather than in Indonesian language. So there is a big scary from the policemaker at that time that the identity of our national will be reduced by the interfering of English language. So at the elementary school level, English is wiped out, and then Bahasa Indonesia is now having big portion. But my research indicated to me that this young generation, which is not display to much English, yeah, will have lag behind, yeah, with other children countries, yeah, from ASEAN, for example, especially for the poor people, for the common people who cannot provide English to their children by sending them to English course. For the young kids from the rich family, can easily or has a facility to send them to English course, and sometimes maybe they go overseas to practice English. So English will become their, yeah, maybe even sometimes daily language talk. This is, in my opinion, how to tackle the this scary situation is that, yeah, we should be more, what is it called? Be more put in display. Yeah, we do not have to be more scary that our nationality will be lessened by so much time using English, because of my finding of my research is that the higher people educate themselves, the higher people complete the study, the more flexible they are in using English, or the more flexible they are in open their mind. Maybe this is the stage of our government, I'm sorry to say, that we are so scary that Bahasa Indonesia will be defeated by English. But my research indicated to me that the people who have a higher education is very flexible, rather than the people who are having, yeah, low educated. Yeah, I think that's all, Hanif.
Yeah, does it really answer your question, Zoana?
Yes, thank you. Yeah. And I think that's also, I just want to share that issue is also a concern here in the Philippines, because others view English as, if you study English, that makes you less of a Filipino, or for example, in Indonesia, if you study English, that makes you less of an Indonesian, but it's actually not. And I think for the education sector, we just have to balance this, our own identity and the language that we are trying to learn. For example, learning English doesn't make us less of our identity. For example, here in the Philippines, there are a lot of good Filipino short stories written by Filipino authors in English. And in that stories, our culture is seen, the local colors is seen. So I think in that way, also Indonesia could promote this, or promise the government that Bahasa Indonesia would not be left behind or be dominated by another language. Because even though we speak in English or we speak on our language, our output, like our stories, our poems and anything, our culture will be seen here. Will be seen there, may it be written in English or in Bahasa Indonesia or in Filipino.
Thank you, Joanna. That's amazing. Thank you.
Yeah, we do hope our governments hear your idea, Joanna, and sharing and learn from Philippines. Another participants, please.
Maybe I just want to add, since I am a teacher, so a little bit, sir. Actually, Mr. Herli Salim already expressed it out before, but
the domination one for how we use English is better now, but it can be shown because it is can be shown only for the metropolitan cities such as Jakarta, Jabodetabek, and also Bandung. Yeah. But in some places, because most of the people are schooling in villages right now, they don't really communicate up in English. And anyway, as we know that Indonesian has around 727 traditional languages, and it should be kept. Actually, for some the governmental values, why they don't really maintain to use in English, because they're afraid that these languages will be, what is it called, will be forgotten. The truth is around 20 to 25 languages, over 700 and something language from Indonesia is actually lost because the native speaker didn't really teach their children about that one. Even me, I am a Batanese, I'm from Medan. I'm still fluent speaking in English and also in Bahasa, and as well as my first language, my mother language, Batanese language. I don't know if some of you can speak in Batanese language here. For example, I've seen before Sahat Samosir, Mas Sahat Samosir, because Samosir is Batanese name. It is actually the marga. I don't know if he is Batanese, and since he lives in Taiwan, right? I don't know.
But yeah.
Again, Miss Joanna. Actually, the government rules for the public school that the English is not a must. But the private one is actually the chance for them because they have to compete, right? The private school should compete with the public school. And the truth is, especially in Jakarta, I think many school teacher here know that Penabur is really known, right? Penabur, Canisius. That name is actually the private school. Why it is known? Because they applied the program that actually more than context that what the public school has, you know? Actually, like what the first time that Mr. Herli explained to us, there is actually the program called the International School. Yeah, Pak Herli, ya? Program RSBI.
Yeah,
ya? Exactly.
Yeah, RSBI, yeah. Yeah,
yeah. Scholar. Actually, the government already make a program before. There is a school fully in English, work with Cambridge, so all of the lessons should be delivered in English. Whether if it is science, mathematics, all of the lessons are delivered in English. But the question is, why it is stopped? Actually, there is actually some funny problem. Why? Because the RSBI teachers are PNS, okay? And then they are paid more than another PNS. Even some teachers such as, you know, honorary teacher, miss, the teacher who are paid lessly, and they complain why it is not fair for us. Why they get better paid, why they get better program, they are treated well rather than us. And at the time, we have the issue for the teachers, that the teachers in Indonesia are paid very lessly. And they are very long to be promoted to be the public teacher, you know, PNS, program CPNS, you know. If they already serve in a school, they will be hired as the governmental school or PNS. And in RSBI, they are promoted well, they are treated well, you know. Even most of the teachers in RSBI school, miss, they are schooled, they are programmed to get the master degree. So most of the teacher there, they are school fit paid, they are program well paid. And, you know, I don't know, maybe we can say that the arrogance or maybe the jealousy, most of the teachers feel jealous, right? Because they are treated better than another school. And then that's why the RSBI is stopped. And then now we maintain for the public school to be the national one and English is stopped. And then you know what? The private school, of course, take the advantage from that one, right? Because they will think that their competitors will be less. You know, even some private school dare to hire the teachers from America, from Australia, or from England. And if they cannot pay for more than that, they will directly hire from Philippines.
Yeah.
Yeah. And at the time, now. Why it is actually for the political one is true? Yeah? Hello?
Yeah, you may continue, Pak Maradut.
Yeah, and then at the time, you know, the private school now dominate the education in Indonesia for most of the time. Even, you know, OSN, Olimpiade, Debat Bahasa, they most likely dominated by the private school. And then you know what? Do you think the public teachers will do the assignment for all? No. Because if you see, miss, for the private teachers in private school, they will teach from 7 a.m. till 3 p.m. But the public school teachers will only teach from 8 till 12. From the 12, yeah. And then if they are offered to work more than that, of course they will not want. They will not want, right? Even though they are English teacher, they don't want, because they are paid by the government. Unlike the private one, because they are challenged by the competitors, they are challenged and then paid by the parents, they have to do better than any other school teachers. But for private schools, almost all private schools in Indonesia, especially in metropolitan city, they applied English very well. They applied English very well. They trained their teachers. For example, me, I am in Catholic school in Kelapa Gading. We are trained to speak in English, and even we are daily to be promoted to get higher school. Some of my friends are taking the graduate degree, master degree. Some of them in UPI, Pak. Some of them, I think, in UNJ, in UPI, to take the master degree in English. And then after they got the education, they will come back to the school and then teach the teachers to speak in English or communicate in English. And it will influence to the students later on, they will speak in English as well. But the public school, the public teachers will directly do that one. Why? Because if they do it so, they will have extra time or extra effort to do that one. But of course they will not. I don't say that all of public schools do that one, no, but most of the public school will do that so. Especially for PNS, they will not do it for more of the time. But for the private school, we applied it actually. And then you know the truth, we the private school really happy if the public school do not apply English. Honestly, why? Because our competitors will be more. Because you know, 70% of the school in Indonesia are public school. 70% of the schools in Indonesia are public school. The rest are religious school and some of them are private school. So how do we, the private school, win the competition? By dominating all the best curriculum, the best teachers, and one of them is to apply the English in use. So while the public will not do it one, of course it is really an advantage for us. But if you say before, what will be the way that the public school or most of the school will apply English? There should be a way actually. If most of the teachers or most of the governmental policy rules maker are actually get educated from another country. For example, like Mr. Herli Halim right now. Pak Herli dari luar negeri kan? Kuliahnya ya?
Yes, from Deakin University, Melbourne, Australia.
Yeah, from Melbourne, from Australia. Our minister, Pak Nadiem Makarim, he is from US. America. But yeah, some of the teachers, some of the governmental rules, and some of the policy makers are not from another country. They're still from Indonesian country. So yeah, maybe the other way that if our government policy rules maker are actually graduated from another country, while their mindset is actually open, maybe it can be applied. And even if you know some of our schools, some of our the government part, like I think the provincial one, you know, Pak Ridwan Kamil, the governor of
Manu.
Yeah, they actually work together with British Council. You know British Council, right? Oh. They work together with British Council. And you know what? The dominatory one for who applied just the private school. The public school do not really like to work much about that one. It is the truth. Even if we see properly in UPI, most of the teachers are not PNS. Most of the teachers are taken from the private schools, right? The private teachers. Jarang-jarang ada PNS jadi ngambil S2, S3. It's actually rare.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
thank you for a lot of sharing, yeah, from the deepest heart of English teacher, yeah, Mr. Marabut. So, I think we have to invite the last participants. A question. Victoria, yeah, please.
Hello. I am just curious if you're using a bahasa in teaching science and mathematics, that's other subjects. Are you using bahasa or?
Yeah.
Oh, I am, because there's this like not really an issue, but some talk or argument here in the Philippines that we should use Filipino in our own language in teaching those subjects. So that's why I ask, and I think teaching those subjects in your own language is more convenient for the students. So that's all.
Okay. Direct answer, Hanif?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Victoria Chuen, for your confirmation that in our elementary school at the lower level, we use our own tribe language, for example, Sundanese with Indonesian language, Japanese with Indonesian language. But at the higher level, in grade 4, 5, and 6, we use fully Bahasa Indonesia or Indonesian language. So it is true that by using our own language, we can try to conserve our own national identity. But because of English is everywhere, 5 years ago, the government is very afraid of that the young generation will be much more fond of English language than Bahasa Indonesia. That's one of the background, one of the reason why the English is omit from the main curriculum. Yeah, but I do agree with you, Victoria, that because language is our own, ethnic is our own mother tongue language, the language which is learned from our mother. Maybe through that point, we can teach our young generation to the belief of this country or to the philosophical of this country. One of the things that we should endorse, we should encourage the people is that we have to push the people to have a higher education, because those who have been experiencing a higher education can have an open mind way of thinking, very flexible, can open opportunity. At the moment, because of the pandemic era, there are many young Indonesian generation who are working overseas because they are knowledgeable in using IT, in chit-chat in English. This is a way maybe for the near future that English indicate to be returned to the main curriculum. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Haley, and also Victoria, and all of the participants. Yeah. Again, a big applause for Mr. Haley, and thank you for your time.
Thank you
for delivering his very interesting topics. And okay, so since it's also our last day of our summer school program, so at the end, I invite Mr. Haley also to give a closing remark for this program. Haley, please.
Okay. My dear friends, my dear colleague, my respective participants, I'm very happy to have this summer school program. We do hope that this academic event will not be last longer. I do invite you to get involved with our program in next semester. And if the pandemic is getting curbed or controlled by other countries, like a country around the globe, that you can visit us here, or maybe you can also strengthen with us through academic event, academic activities, through social media. And once again, we lived in the pearl of Ecuador. We live in the exactly of the line of world, line of the universe, many beautiful island, many beautiful flora, many beautiful ocean we have here in Indonesia, many tribes, many cultures. So if you have in mind intention to go to Indonesia, yeah, I do invite you to come over and visit us in here in UPI Serang. I will provide you with kind of facilities, for example, picking up from the airport and staying here in our dormitory. And you can get involved with our students here. Here in UPI Serang, we have elementary school department, early childhood department, we have fish and marine department, we have information system marine, we have a logistic marine. So we, in a big picture, we have education cluster as well as maritime education study program cluster. Once again, thank you so much for your participation in our school program. Please tell your friends that this program will be issued every semester. And I request to Pak Hanif as the organizing committee to provide the participant with recognition in the form of a certificate. Once again, thank you so much for your participation. See you again in other school, summer school program of UPI Kampus Serang. Once again, thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Riley. And yeah, everyone, again, thank you so much for having very great 2 weeks with this summer school program. And don't forget, after this, I will have a bit information related to our essay assignment, essay, and also the information about your certificate, admission, and others. So, Mr. Haley, it's better to end this section by taking a photograph before you leaving us.
Taking photo together.
So, please, everyone, could you turn on your camera? I will count the next. Okay, so sorry. One, two, three, go. Wait a moment. Once more, you may change your style. One, two, three, go. Okay, so again, thank you, Mr. Haley. We have another
interview. And goodbye, everyone. Thank you very much for your participation.
Yeah.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, yeah, thank you again for Mr. Haley and for all the participants. The last information will be about our last assignment. Yeah, it's about the essays. I will share to you the templates of essays. Yeah, it's not a big deal related to Mr. Tatang previously told you yesterday. So we have 2 days. Yeah, waiting for your full essays. So it is Thursday. I will wait for your complete essay on Saturday. Yeah. So you have, I think two days more than enough to create a short essay in 2 or 3 pages. I will share in the group, in WhatsApp group. And related to the admission, for your certificates, I do hope I will check, and I do hope all of you have complete the admission through the admission link I previously at the first meeting share. Yeah, I will check and make sure some of all of you have completed the admission. So, any question before we close this?
Could you please share with us more in detail about the instructions for the essay? For example, how many words? And then what is the topic? Something like that. And the deadline, time, and day. Just make it very clear so we all can understand. How to do it.
So actually, all of the requirements are written here. Yeah. So about the templates. It's about the templates and the topics. I have shared in the book program and also remind again in this part. Yeah. So you have been assigned an expository essay. On topic of addressing students' diversity. On teaching context, and the topic includes but not limit, so you may find the other related topics related to this main themes addressing students' diversity in ethnopedagogy teaching context. It can be an idea of ethnopedagogy based on your culture, idea of addressing diversity, just like for example that our lecture from Nebraska, Professor Jeff previously told us, situational settings, exploration on diversity you have experienced, and also multicultural education idea and other related topics. Pak Sahat. So it includes but not limit. So you can address, or if you wonder that your topics or your title or your idea includes or not in these big themes, you may ask. We will have a team. You will have team to edit, to edit what we call a review your works later, and then compile all of your works into a book chapter. So you may have a question in WhatsApp group or directly chat me, and then I will forward to the team. So in this template, you have to provide a brief introduction. You have a bit about how to write this part. About the length. It's about 100 to 300 words. So maybe it will be
1,000, right?
1,000 to 3,000 words. It's about 2 or 3 pages, if I'm not mistaken, with these templates. Exclude the abstract. The abstract, so it will be 1,000 to 3,000. Exclude the abstract. Introduction. Body of idea, or directly address your topics or your titles. For example, maybe you want to raise the issues from your country or your area or your experience. So directly you may this what we call subhead with your titles. For example, maybe previously we talked about I forget what's the name of game from Philippines.
similar to Indonesia? Yeah, you may directly at the Luksong. You may directly what we call replace the body of idea with the idea of the main topic of your writings. Yeah, Luksong technique for teaching mathematics, for example. That's okay. The body of essay is where you cover your topic in depth. Yeah, it comprises 60% to 80% of your essay. So when it's about,
excuse me, sir. Mm-hmm. Sir Hanif, will you share this?
Yeah. I will share. In
Hanif,
If you have a table or figure, I also have different maths here. You can read later. It's not quite difficult. Make it as pleasant as possible. Yeah, just like Mr. Tatang's request previously, that your essay is your reflection. So please find something close to your. And then
conclusion.
Yeah. Sorry, Mr. Zakaria.
Oh, okay, you can go ahead to finish your explanation. Sorry.
Okay. So conclusion. Yeah, you have a brief conclusion and a bit maybe acknowledgement and reference if you have. Yeah, we suggest you to have some reference there to support your idea. Maybe you can have a bit literature review to support your idea or strengthen the topics, yeah, in depth. Yeah, I will share this in this chat room and also the WhatsApp group. Yeah, and the deadline is Saturday, September 4th.
Yeah. How about I saw briefly at the top of paper there is a supervisor, Pak.
As previously I mentioned that some of you students from university, if you want to add your supervisor as the collaborator of this essay, you may add your supervisor. For example, some of our counterparts from Philippines, students, and they are informed about this program from their supervisor. So you may invite your supervisor to collaborate writing this essay. Maybe they also can give you a good suggestion about what you have to write in this essay. Yeah, so it's optional. Yeah, you may, but of course, this for the second. Yeah. First name, if it amass your name. Another part that you are not really understood, you may omit or leave. It will be taken by the committee. For example, how to type, it will be placed or taken by the committee. Since it these words will be compiled into a book chapter later. And I forget. At the end of this section or this program, I will also provide you access to all of the materials and the summary of the lecture. Yeah, I will provide you the summary, the books, the newest book program, the video recording, and also the certificate. So I will share in WhatsApp group and also send you an email to make sure your presence, and also admissions. It's in a clip. Victoria, you want to say something?
I just want to ask if it necessary for us to write the essay in the format that you gave, like there's an abstract, introduction.
I mean the templates, yeah, the order, it should be in this line, yeah, but then the content you have freedom to, yeah, you have freedom to write everything since it's exploratory essay, so it is common templates tutorial, so it's very common, so no worries about the structure or anything strictly your idea, yeah, it's a very common template, so
okay,
yeah, you should it's necessary to follow this template. Any others? No one? Okay, so if you have any further question, assistance or anything, you can directly contact me through emails or in WhatsApp group. Yeah, later I will share this template in WhatsApp group and also send to your email. Again, it's very great honor, yeah, to guide you during this 2 weeks. It's a very happy weeks, yeah, having you in this agenda. So I do hope in the next agenda we'll also have you in to strengthen our relationship, yeah, friendship and so everyone, thank you again and goodbye.
Thank you, Pani.
Yeah. See you.
The feedback link for the last day, sir. How can I get it?
Oh yeah, presence.
Yeah. Oh, will you send it in the WhatsApp group, maybe?
Sorry, pardon.
Feedback link of the last day. Evaluation. I don't know what is it. Evaluation form for the last day.
Link for attendance or what?
Oh, presence list.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, Pak Hani, thank you very much. Yeah, for organizing this wonderful event. Yeah, personally, I learned a lot about teaching knowledge. Yeah, and also from Philippines. Yeah, Joanna and Victoria and her friends. Yeah, we hope that we can learn a lot of things through this useful discussion. So, if you have another event, Pak Hanif, you also can share with us. Yeah, in the near time, and then we can join again. Yeah, let us know what to do. Yeah, what we can do. Yeah, to support your event, even if we are as participants. I think it is very honor for us to be a part of your event in the future.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Saad, and everyone. Sorry, I have a trouble with my connection previously, so I can reach the presence list. So
yeah, I think you can just send it in the WhatsApp group. Yeah.
No problem. I will send to WhatsApp group. So yeah, that's all for this program. Thank you, everyone. Again, I will close this meeting. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
See you next agenda.
Ini salah siapa?